we want to come out of this with anything, we're going to have to sell the coal.
Yes, Digvijay, let's start.
Okay, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Digvijay. I'm the state lead for West Bengal. Today is our first ever Spice Route West Bengal academic session. This is just a start. We wish to organize much more sessions in the future like this. So today we have arranged a case discussion based on malaria. And our speaker is going to be our Spice Route West Bengal State Secretary, Dr. Gourav Banerjee. So we will take questions after the session. So over to you, Dr. Gourav.
Thank you, Digvijay. Very good evening, everyone. On behalf of Spice Route West Bengal State Council, I welcome you all to this academic meet. And I also like to thank Spice Route National Council for giving me this opportunity. As Digvijay mentioned, today's discussion will be on malaria. In the first part, I will present a case as a whole and the transition towards the patient's recovery. And in the second part, I will take you through the malaria discussion proper. Okay, so let's start the presentation. Is it visible?
Yes.
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So, let's move on. It is about a 57-year-old male who is a CISF Jawan, was posted here for election duty in May 2014. I understand this is a little bit old case. He was hailing from Andhra Pradesh. On 10th May, one day after starting his posting, he developed high-grade fever, vertigo, and low backache. He was initially taken to the subdivisional hospital with conservative management, but his condition further deteriorated with increasing creatinine, urea, and he was later shifted to a tertiary care facility 5 days after his presentation to SDH. Past medical history is significant, where he was suffering from chronic liver disease, which was alcohol induced. He was splenectomized due to possible hyperspiration, which is also related to chronic liver disease, although he was non-diabetic and non-hypertensive. At emergency general survey show, he was febrile, pulse rate was 112 per minute, regular, hemodynamically was okay, and respiratory rate was 30 per minute, with mild pallor, with jaundice, but no clubbing and edema, and no lymphadenopathy was noted. I think there is an echo in my voice.
No, now it's fine.
It's okay, fine.
Now it's fine, okay.
Neurological examination, he was drowsy, disoriented, but moving all the limbs spontaneously. Jerks was 2+ in all limbs. Plantar was bilateral extensor. Nuchal rigidity was positive. Pupil were equally reacting to light and 3 mm in diameter. Cardiovascular system and the respiratory system did not reveal any abnormality. GI system, there was no tongue bite. Abdomen was protuberant. At right iliac fossa and left subcostal region, There were two scar marks. Right iliac fossa possibly due to appendicectomy, and the left subcostal was due to splenectomy. No superficial venous prominence or other stigmata of chronic liver disease was found apart from jaundice. Liver was 4 centimeters below the subcostal line with a 16 centimeter liver span and firm and coarse in texture. Obviously, it was splenectomy, so no spleen was palpable. On admission, his blood ABG blood pH was 7.39 with a low PO2 and very low bicarbonate. His TL total lymphocyte count was 14,490 with a significant thrombocytopenia, but he was not bleeding from any orifices. His urea was 126, creatinine was 3.8 by low bicarbonate and low albumin level. SGOT was 115, but within normal range SGPT, and serum ammonia was 132. His blood test, malaria parasite dual antigen test, was came positive for falciparum malaria, and the peripheral smear showed a ring form of falciparum with a parasite load of 7,095 per microliter. So from this discussion with the investigation, it is clear that we are dealing with a severe falciparum malaria in a splenectomized patient with a background history of alcoholic liver disease. Further course, one day after his presentation into this tertiary facility, he developed a generalized tonic-clonic seizure with a deteriorating ABG status with very low pH and with increasing lactate. He was intubated and ventilated. General measures were critical care setup, and the specific treatment for falciparum malaria was instituted, like artesunate and the clindamycin. It is his investigation chart. This total transition is noted here. So what one thing we can see here, we are having a little bit of high total count, which was initially was also raised, but his platelet count started recovering following the institution of treatment, with a little bit deteriorating the creatinine, for which was put on renal replacement treatment. And initially his SGOT, SGPT level started rising, but after a few days, it again started normalizing. Further course, his urea creatinine was started rising, so hence RRT were given. Liver enzyme initially started, later on settled. Blood gas also started improving. Primaquine single dose was given. On third day, he was extubated and maintained. Hemodynamically, he became stable, although he never required any ionotropic support. Cognition also started improving. On eighth day in hospital, he developed a fever again, which was found to be due to MDR Klebsiella. It is in a central line infection, was treated with polymyxin E. And he recovered and discharged after 15 days of hospital stay. So now in the second part, I'm going into the malaria discussion proper. Malaria, the term came from the contracted form of malaria, which is thought as bad air. It came from Italian origin.
Sorry, can I just interrupt?
Yeah,
Dr. Gauru? Yeah. To the audience, if you have any questions related to the case, do you want to ask now, or you can also post it in the chat box? Anybody having any questions?
Good evening, ma'am. This is Krishna from Andhra Pradesh.
Yes, Dr. Krishna, please tell me.
Ma'am, just I have a doubt. Actually, this case presentation for examination are like to discuss malaria only.
It is for discussion of malaria.
Oh, okay. Why? Because I thought like case presentation in articles, then it is not like format. Okay, that's the answer.
Fine. If anyone has any questions, please put it in the chat box. Yes, Dr. Gaurav, please continue.
Okay. Thank you. We all know malaria is a life-threatening but preventable and curable disease. globally, there are 220 million cases were reported globally with a 0.4 million death, which is a 2019 World Malaria Report. And less than 5 years, group is more vulnerable, which comprises of around 67% mortality. African region carry a disproportionate high share of this global morbidity and mortality burden. India, it is falciparum malaria is a major public threat, and India shares about 3% of global burden, of which 47% vivax and the 50% of falciparum malaria. Our 22% population live in the high transmission area. National framework for elimination of malaria in India started in 2016 to 2030. Having said that, India is doing much better recently following this implementation of the national framework for elimination of malaria in India, which showed a reduction of cases and death, respectively 47% and 50.5% in comparison with 2017. And this is the vision, goals and objective for the national framework for elimination of malaria, where the goal is to eliminate malaria, the zero indigenous case throughout the entire country by 2030, and to maintain the malaria free status in the high transmission zone. Okay. So we all know that etiologically it is a genus, the parasite is called Plasmodium. It has a 4 species which infect humans. In India, around 47% cases are vivax, and falciparum malaria is around 53% with a very rare incidence of malaria and ovale. And Nolesi malaria parasite is a simian malarial parasite occasionally reported from the Southeast Asia. The vector is Anopheles stephens species, the only vector for malaria. There are 45 species, only few are very important, like Calciphasis, Fluviatilis, Stephensi. And in India, the Calciphasis are important for the rural area and the Stephensi in the urban area. The etiologic factor host, humans is a intermediate host and the mosquito is a definitive host, with an incubation period for falciparum malaria is around 12 days and the vivax malaria is around 14 days. Now coming to the life cycle, this malaria parasite has a two cycle, one going on in the inside mosquito. There is a sexual cycle and another is the asexual cycle, which occurs in the human. Following a blood meal, the gametocytes enter into the mosquito, the gut, they fertilize with the male-female gamete, the zygote formation and oocyte formation happens. Then it comes into the salivary gland, the sporozoites. After the another blood meal, the sporozoite was deposited into the tissue. The sporozoite deposited in the tissue, it takes around 2 to 60 minutes to enter into the hepatocyte. And in the hepatocyte, it stays around 6 days. And develop into liver stage schizont. This schizont then converted into merozoite. A single hepatocyte contain around 10,000 to 40,000 merozoite, and then it ruptures and enter into the discharge into the blood and enters into the RBC. And there stays for around 24 hours and become the from the trophozoite phase to the schizont phase. From the schizont phase, there is a two pathway. One, few develop into male and female gamete, and few schizont infect the fresh RBCs, and it takes around 48 hours. And then again, from the fresh RBCs and the merozoite again released, and this erythrocytic cycle continues. This is a total cycle duration for falciparum malaria is around 48 hours. And following the blood meal, this gamete enter into the fertilization occurs inside the mosquito. The sporozoite rapidly pass through the hepatic sinusoid, and passes through the Kaffa cell in the liver and chooses the correct hepatocyte and bores into the parasitophorus vacuole. The sulfated heparin glycan on the hepatocyte is the receptor for the falciparum malaria parasite. Release of up to 40,000 merozoite from the single hepatocyte occurs, and the merozoite infect the RBC through the receptor ligand interaction between the sialic acid glycoporin A and erythrocyte binding antigen. The falciparum malaria usually infects the fresh and the newly synthesized RBC or the reticulocyte through this reticulocyte binding protein homolog 5. Inside the red cell, this parasite consumes the hemoglobin and the forms the hemozoin pigment, and the maturation cycle starts. And the trophozoite secretes the protein. It's called the membrane protein 1, which forms the knob on the RBC surface. And this knob binds to the endothelial cell in the capillary venule. Okay. This knob causes the blockage of the microcirculation, and hence there's a tissue hypoxia occurs in the falciparum malaria. The maturation of the trophozoite occurs and the merozoites are released, and the merozoite invade the normal RBC, and this cycle continues for around 48 hours. The pathophysiology of falciparum malaria is the destruction of erythrocyte, liberation of parasite and erythrocytic material, and the host reaction by the releasing of cytokines, and also the erythrocyte sequestration with interfering with the microcirculatory flow and interferes with the host tissue metabolism. And the toxicity happens with the release of the TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, interleukin-1, and these are the other pyrogenic interleukins, and it is responsible for the fever and the malaise. Following the season rupture, there is a release of TNF-alpha, and which causes these paroxysms of shivering, cool extremity due to vasodilation, headache, chill, rigor. The sequestration, the erythrocyte containing the mature falciparum cytoadhere to the microvasculature and disappear from the peripheral circulation. And there it completes the asexual cycle. The mature parasite of falciparum are rarely seen in the peripheral blood, and the ring form is the immature form, which is usually seen in the peripheral blood. Cytoadherence, the falciparum erythrocyte membrane protein, which forms the knob, and the CD36 ligand, ICAM1, and converting sulfate A. And these are the important receptor for this cytoadherence. And P. falciparum switches to the new variant of this falciparum erythrocyte membrane protein around at the rate of 2% per asexual cycle. So it actually changes itself. The rosetting is a important phenomena occurs in malaria infection. It occurs in the uninfected RBC. It is also similar to the cytoadherence, which impedes the forward flow of non-infected RBC and also causes the static hindrance. The aggregation with the platelet-mediated aggregation of infected RBC occurs via CD36 associated with the disease severity. That is why sometimes we get a thrombocytopenia in malaria. RBC deformability with the parasite of falciparum malaria infect RBC become the more rigid, and it is a sign of disease severity, and the P5X infected RBC become more deformable. So this is a liver stage season. One hepatocyte containing this so much amount of seasoned in this liver. And we can see here is in scanning electron microscope is a ruptured erythrocyte, and this is an unruptured erythrocyte contain the merozoites. And this is a knob which forms over the RBC membrane. And this is one microcirculation, this is one capillary lumen, which is actually become rigid and is blocked by the parasite infested RBC. And this is this venule packed with parasite erythrocyte. This is another electromicrographic picture. And this is a scanning freeze fracture micrograph of RBC. I think this roughness, this is actually the knob which occurs in the falciparum malaria. And this is actually a schematic representation of the cytoadherence of falciparum malaria. We can see this PFEMP1, ICAM1, CD36, this is a host cell. This is parasitized erythrocyte. And these are the protein, which helps in cytoadherence and clogging the microsphere. And this is the rosette formation occurs in the vivax malaria and the rosette in the falciparum malaria. There's some interspecies differences. The vivax and the ovule have a prolonged liver stage that is called the hypnozoite. And this is the reason for the relapse occurs in the vivax and ovule infection. And vivax merozoite cannot invade the Duffy blood group. Though those who are deficient of this Duffy blood group get little bit protection of malaria infection, and the globin gene defect gives a partial protection against malaria. The diagnosis based on the clinical diagnosis, signs and symptoms are non-specific. Severe malaria initially mimics other infectious disease such as encephalitis, sepsis, severe pneumonia, typhoid. So the most important thing is high index of suspicion with a low threshold to test. The clinical features, first symptom of malaria initially resembles influenza. This is a clinical feature for the uncomplicated malaria. The initial symptoms resemble the influenza, headache, myalgia, vague abdominal discomfort, lethargy may precede the 2 days before the onset of fever, with an erratic rise of temperature, shivering, chill, which is due to the TNF-alpha and other interleukin release, headache and malaise. The children become irritable, lethargic, and anorexic. There is a tertian pattern of fever pattern, 2 day cycle seen in vivax and ovule. So fever comes every third day. And in malaria, there is a quartan fever pattern. The fever comes every fourth day. So now we are dealing with severe malaria. Most commonly caused by the Plasmodium falciparum, vivax and nolesi can also cause a severe malaria. So the definition of severe malaria is acute malaria with a signs of severity and or evidence of vital organ dysfunction. Detailed clinical feature I will come later on. It is invariably fatal if untreated or delayed. So the clinical features of severe malaria, there may be an impaired consciousness. The GCS may be less than 11 or Blantyre coma scale for less than 3, which is used in children. The prostration, convulsion more than 2 episodes in 24 hours, acidosis with a base deficit of more than 8 or bicarbonate less than 15. Or venous lactate more than 5 millimoles per liter, hypoglycemia with severe malarial anemia with the hemoglobin level less than 7 in adult and hemoglobin less than 5 in children with a parasite count of 10,000 per microliter, renal impairment with a rising urea and creatinine level, jaundice with a bilirubin level more than 3 with a parasite count of 1 lakh per microliter. These are actually a case definition for severe malaria. Pulmonary edema, any of these combination can be present in a patient. Pulmonary edema clinically or radiologically confirmed with respiratory rate more than 30, with a significant bleeding, shock compensated with CRT more than 3 seconds but no hypotension, or decompensated systolic blood pressure less than 80 or less than 50 in child, with a hyperparasitemia more than 10%. So the young children, visitors from the non-endemic area, second and third trimester of pregnancy, HIV and AIDS, and splenomegaly person are particularly at more risk. Severe Vivax malaria is less common than falciparum. Although some symptoms are similar, it can be fatal. The young children and the other comorbidities are the high risk group. Severe Nolesi malaria is defined as for falciparum. In Asia, isolated island of Borneo, there is a P. malaria like infection with a parasite load more than 1 lakh per microliter. Usually, the severe Nolesi malaria does not occur in India. This is a Blantyre coma scale used in the less than 5 years who do not learn to speak. This is for just a reference. And this is, I think, everyone knows is a Glasgow coma scale. The P. falciparum remains erratic and the no regular tertian pattern or the fever pattern can be seen. The paroxysm of rigor is the most common with the Vivax and Ovale than the falciparum. So that this tertian or quartan fever pattern may not be seen in the falciparum malaria. The parasitemia at which the fever occurs is times the pyrogenic density. The immune subject can tolerate the higher pyrogenic density, hence it is a marker of immunity and the lower risk for severe disease. The parasitological diagnosis, the microscopy is still the gold standard. It is stained by Jim Sustain. We do thick and thin smear. The advantage of doing a thick smear, it is sensitive of 0.001% parasitemia and species specific and less expensive. But disadvantage, it needs expertise and underestimate the true count. On the other hand, the thin smear, it is rapid, inexpensive, and the prognostic information we get from the parasite load. But it is insensitive, where we need a little bit more parasitemia than the thick smear, as Vivax infected large RBC stays in the leading edge. There is another method of doing a parasitological diagnosis is a fluorescent microscopy. And this is a picture, the thin blood film showing the Plasmodium falciparum, where the sequential, there is a young trophozoite, old trophozoite, the pigment in the polymorphonuclear cell, this pigment is a mature cyzoid, is a female gametocyte and the male gametocyte. The parasitological index, it is counted, it can be done in a thin smear or the thick smear. In thin smear, it is counted with the corresponding RBC count, the number of infected RBC in relation to the number of uninfected RBCs. A minimum 500 RBC total should be counted and it is given as a percent infected RBC. On the other hand, in the thick smear, the number of parasites in relation to the standard number of WBC taken as 8,000 and it is given as a number of parasites per microliter. So they are interchangeable. So around 10,000 parasites per microliter is equal to the 0.2% of parasitemia. The poor prognostic sign for falciparum malaria, if there is a 2% parasitemia or 1 lakh per microliter is an increased risk for severe malaria. More than 20% of the parasite with a visible pigment in severe falciparum malaria, or more than 5% of the polymorph containing the phagocytosed pigment. But the presence of gametocyte without asexual form does not indicate active infection. This is the development stage of the falciparum malaria during a 48-hour asexual cycle. From this mid-trophozoite to the cyzoid phase, usually not seen in the peripheral smear, but if it is present in the peripheral smear, this denotes a large parasite biomass associated with severe disease. rapid diagnostic test for falciparum malaria as well as the Vivax malaria done with the mechanism of immune chromatography. Histidine-rich protein for falciparum and the PLDH for falciparum and other species are used. The advantage is it is a rapid, having a sensitivity of 95% with asexual parasite density more than 200 and is also highly specific. But the disadvantage, it does not quantitate the parasitemia and it might remain positive for weeks following treatment. And the LDH may miss a little low level of paracetamol and also not a species specific. So these are the standard kit which are usually used. Here we can see this is actually a negative for malaria, and it is a positive for P5X malaria. So the interpretation, if both microscopy and the rapid diagnostic test are negative, so there is extremely negative chance of malaria. And if the PF line is positive, it is considered, it is a falciparum infection. If the PV line is positive, it is a vivax malaria. If both lines are positive, it is considered as a mixed infection. Rapid diagnostic test should not be used for the follow-up as antigen remained positive for more than 4 weeks. Now coming to the treatment, uncomplicated malaria. Vivax, ovale and malaria, it is in India, we get it as a chloroquine sensitive malaria. Very rarely it is not reported from the chloroquine resistance is not reported in India until now. The dose of chloroquine is 25 milligram per kg body weight divided over 3 days. On day one, you have to give a 10 milligram per kg. And on the day two, and 10 milligram per kg. And on day three, 5 milligram per kg. With a primaquine at a 0.25 milligram per kg body weight daily for 14 days under supervision. This primaquine is used to treat the liver stage season to prevent relapse. This is a guideline as per the national. This is a national vector-borne disease control program. And Vivax, WHO recommend if chloroquine resistance, WHO recommendation is to treat with ACT with primaquine for 14 days. This is a dosage chart for treatment of Vivax malaria. It's a chloroquine 250 milligram tablet have a 150 milligram base. Whatever we calculate here is based on the base, not the whole tablet. The falciparum malaria, uncomplicated in northeastern state, weight or age specific, ACT AL, artemether lumefantrine for 3 days with a primaquine single dose on second day. In other states in India, we treat it with artemisinin combination therapy with sulfadoxine pyrimethamine for 3 days with a primaquine single dose on second day. So what is the rationale of this artemisinin based therapy is we give it a fixed drug combination. There is a two component. One is rapidly acting artemisinin derivative, longer acting partner drug, which is slow eliminating. The artemisinin actually clears initially and rapidly the asexual parasite rapidly and is also against the sexual stage. The partner drug clears the remaining parasite and protects against developing the resistance of artemisinin. And three days course is recommended. WHO recommends ACT. Of the five drug in India, artemether lumefantrine and artemether artesunate and sulfadoxine pyrimethamine are recommended by NVBDCP. Although these other combinations is also available in India. The artemether lumefantrine combination is a co-formulated tablet which is given twice daily dose, total 6 doses. First dose should be 8 hours apart. To be given with food for better absorption, and it is not recommended for children less than 5 kg and first trimester of pregnancy. And there is a dose range for artemether is 5 to 24 milligram per kg body weight, and lumefantrine for 29 to 144 milligram per kg weight. Although we use this fixed dose combination, is the color coding. Those who are working in government setup, they get this color-coded this package for 5 to 14 kg, 6 tablets are given and more than 34 in adult, 24 tablet given. So to consume the 4 tablet twice daily for 3 days. An artesunate sulfadoxine for the rest of the state other than northeastern state, is it comes as a blister pack. And sulfadoxine pyrimethamine given on the first day of single as a single dose. And resistance likely to increase with sulfadoxine and should be monitored. And there's a dosage range, artesunate is 4 mg/kg body weight once daily. And this is a sulfur dioxide given on the first day only. And on the second day, the single dose primaquine to be given. Falciparum malaria and the pregnancy, uncomplicated. In the first trimester, the drug of choice is quinine, 10 mg/kg base, thrice daily for 7 days orally. And watchful for hypoglycemia as frequent meal and no fasting with clindamycin can be added. It is as per WHO, but Indian guideline does not recommend clindamycin or any other medicine with quinine. For second and third trimester in pregnancy, the ACT therapy as per standard protocol and location specific can be used, but the primaquine is contraindicated. An infant weighing less than 5 kg with uncomplicated falciparum malaria with an ACT at the same milligram per kg body weight target dose as for children weighing 5 kg. Primaquine, it is indicated for the radical cure of vivax and ovule malaria to reduce the onward transmission of falciparum malaria. It is highly active against hypnozoid and the gametocyte. Sterilization of gamete is an immediate effect, although the clearance takes time, hour versus day, rapidly absorbed through gut, the 96% bioavailability. The active metabolite generated through cytochrome metabolism is antimalarial, and also it causes the hemolytic side effect. So for giving a radical cure in vivax and ovule malaria, the dose is 0.25 mg per kg body weight given 14 days. And for the gametocidal in falciparum, which is given as a single dose, and 0.75 mg per kg, maximum dose 45 mg, which is Indian guideline recommend to be given on second day, but WHO recommend to be given on first day. And G6PD testing is recommended for radical cure, but not for single dose. The contraindication for giving primaquine is infant, pregnancy, and the person who is G6PD deficient. Now come to the severe falciparum malaria treatment. Artesunate with a 2.4 mg per kg IV given at 0, 12, and 24 hours, then once daily. Artemether dose is 3.2 mg per kg IM at 0 hours, then 1.6 mg per kg per day. And quinine, 20 mg salt per kg loading, and then 10 mg per kg 8 hourly to be given as infusion. The duration of therapy it to be given at least 24 hours. If the patient is able to tolerate the oral, 3 days of artemisinin-based combination therapy to be started with a full oral course of area-specific ACT. In northeastern state, weight-specific ACT AL, or in other state, ACT SP to be given with a primaquine single dose on second day. In pregnancy with severe malaria, IV quinine is a preferable in the first trimester as per our Indian guideline, but WHO recommends parenteral artesunate is the treatment of choice. Young children less than 20 kg who requires actually higher parenteral dosing at the rate of 3 mg per kg per dose, it is as per the pharmacokinetic modeling. What are the non-recommended treatment for severe malaria? So given heparin, glucocorticoid, aspirin, anti-TNF antibody, pentoxifilin, N-acetylcysteine, albumin globulus, etc. The supportive care definitely need to be given hydration, nutrition, maintaining of glycemia, blood transfusion if hemoglobin less than 7. Exchange blood transfusion, evidence is lacking, but can be given. There's a logistic problem in the peripheral or rural hospital, but can be given in tertiary care hospital, although it requires a huge amount of blood, around 4.5 to 5 liter to give a complete exchange blood transfusion. Antibiotic concomitant or early addition, if no clinical improvement following administering of antimalarial drug to be given. And none, but not the least, malaria vaccine. There is a one candidate vaccine which is approved by WHO, which is called RTS-SA-S01 vaccine for falciparum malaria. It is being started in Kenya, Ghana, and Malawi since 2019. Already 1 million doses is being already being given in Kenya, and which is although this malaria vaccine is low immunogenic, this is recommended as a four dose regime, 6 weeks to 18 months age group, given as a 0, 1, 1, and 18. It is combined with hepatitis B. With all this, I conclude. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. It was a very extensive presentation on malaria. So anyone, do you have any questions? So Dr. Gaurav can take them. Please post the questions in the chat box. Dr. Gaurav, can I ask a question?
Surely, surely.
So the case you mentioned, the Jawan from Andhra Pradesh, so he had a history of splenectomy, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that might be the reason why he got the severe malaria.
Possibly.
Okay.
Actually, the patient presented on to us on fifth day. So there was lacking, the patient is having a high grade fever. So that is why I have mentioned, you must have a low threshold to test, high index of suspicion and low threshold. When he presented with high grade fever, and have a increasing creatinine and urea, the SDS Subdivision Hospital did not go for the malaria testing. Otherwise, this severity could have been averted with the early institution of treatment.
Yes, yes.
Because his parasite load was not that much high.
Yes.
Okay. We are telling about the parasite load around, if there is a poor prognosis or hyperparasitemia, 2%, 1 lakh per microliter. His parasite load was only 7,000 something. But even then, yes, he presented with this having a feature of severe malaria.
Okay.
If there are no more questions, Dr. Digbijoy, you want to wrap up the session?
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am, for joining. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, residents. So we will wrap this up. And if you have any questions, you can post in the WhatsApp group. And we will, Dr. Gaurab will surely address them. We also have a YouTube link, and anyone who has missed, you can forward the YouTube link to them. So thank you, Dr. Gaurab.
Thank you. Welcome.
Good night, everyone. Thank you for joining.
Thank you all. Good session. Yeah, good night.
Good night.